All right, we are in Romans chapter 4, a little advance warning. We have class this week, and then next week we will not meet on Christmas Sunday. That's not my decision. I just from on high gave orders. So, all right, we will not have Sunday school on Christmas Day. I'm not going to begin the next section of Romans, which is 5 through 8, until the new year. So I'm going to kind of wrap up on chapter 4 this week, and I'm going to look at the Abrahamic covenant, which is front and center in chapter 4, here today, as well as in Luke's gospel, and then in Galatians next week, as we come up on Christmas, looking at Christmas in the light of the Abrahamic covenant. And then in the new year, beginning January 1st, we will start at Romans 5, and 5 through 8 is the next section. And I hope that during the Christmas time, before we come to start this, you'd take the opportunity to read 5 through 8 whole and entire at one sitting. Whole and entire at one sitting. And with this in mind, Romans 5 through 8 is often treated as the next section in Romans, following justification, therefore dealing with sanctification. Justification leads into sanctification. To get one illustration of that, when I was a new convert in college, one of the big writers of the time was John Stott, still is in many ways, but particularly big in those days. He wrote a little commentary on just that section in Romans, Romans 5 through 8, called Men Made New, Men Made New. And from the very title, you get the idea that this section is about sanctification. It's about people who were justified by faith being made new. Now, for John Stott to write a book on that, there must be something in there about sanctification, and I do not deny that it is about sanctification. However, I do not think that sanctification is the main point of that particular section. And just by way of brief proof, without arguing the point any more than this one point, as you get near the end, Romans chapter 8, you get what's called the golden chain of salvation. Following the verse we all know in Romans chapter 8, that God works all things together for good with those who love God, who are called according to his purpose, you then get the golden chain, verses 29 and 30. For whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son. Whom he predestined, these he also called. Whom he called, these he also justified. Whom he justified, these he also glorified. If sanctification were the main focus of Romans 5 through 8, why does it not get mentioned in the golden chain? It very clearly comes between justification and glorification. Quite clearly, it comes between there, as we know from the rest of Scripture. But Paul doesn't even mention it. He gives you five links in the golden chain that stretch from eternity past. Whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son. It goes to eternity to come. Whom he justified, these he also glorified. In time, he hits upon our calling, our being brought out of bondage to sin and death, called to Christ in faith and repentance. Whom he called, these he also justified. That takes place in time. But he skips entirely sanctification. So I don't think it could be the main focus of the section, which is not to say there isn't much in there that pertains to sanctification. Okay? What would be the main thing of the section? Well, I will argue that the main theme of Romans 5 to 8 is the assurance of salvation. Romans 4 sets it up by telling us that Abraham received circumcision, the sign of circumcision, as a seal. A seal was intended to guarantee, all right? This is like a notary seal on a paper. It's to guarantee the truth of whatever's written on that piece of paper. All right? If your signature on a mortgage or something like that, that seal is there so that anybody else taking that document in hand will know that you had indeed signed that document, you had made the pledge to fulfill that mortgage, etc. That seal was there to guarantee the truth of what was written. And that's what circumcision was to do. It was to guarantee the promise of God to give righteousness to those who had faith. It guaranteed it. And Paul said it was based on faith precisely so that the promise could be guaranteed to those who had received the promise, to those who believed. So it was there for a guarantee. Then in Romans 5, he goes on, therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. We rejoice in hope of the glory of God. So right at the beginning, he is pointing us to the fact that having been justified, we have hope, and this is biblical hope, not in the sense of wishing. A biblical hope is not a wish concerning the future. It is a firm expectation. We rejoice in hope of the glory of God. That is to say, we rejoice because we are certain that we will enjoy the glory of God, having been justified by faith. What he picks up at the beginning of Romans chapter 5, he comes back to at the end of Romans chapter 8. That there is nothing that can separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus. So you have here a good Hebrew inclusio, where you wrap up in the middle what you highlight at the end. So at the beginning, at the end of the passage, he is focusing our attention on the certainty of salvation to those who have been justified by faith. So, with assurance as your guiding star, read Romans 5 through 8. Okay? And the Abrahamic promise is highlighted in Romans 4 and elsewhere in the New Testament precisely for that purpose, and that's what we're looking at today. But let's look just at the end of Romans 4, and then we're going to go back into Luke's gospel. Verse 16, Romans 4. That is why it depends on faith, in order that the promise may rest on grace and be guaranteed to all his offspring, not only to the adherent of the law, but also to the one who shares the faith of Abraham, who is the father of us all. And the us in there is Jew and Gentile alike. The father of us all. As it is written, I have made you the father of many nations, in the presence of the God in whom he believed, who gives life to the dead and calls into existence the things that do not exist. In hope, he believed against hope that he should become the father of many nations. As he had been told, so shall your offspring be. He did not weaken in faith when he considered his own body, which was as good as dead, since he was about 100 years old, or when he considered the barrenness of Sarah's womb. No distrust made him waver concerning the promise of God, but he grew strong in his faith as he gave glory to God, fully convinced that God was able to do what he had promised. That is why his faith was counted to him as righteousness. But the words, "it was counted to him," were not written for his sake alone, but for ours also. It will be counted to us who believe in him who raised him from the dead, Jesus our Lord, who was delivered up for our trespasses and raised for our justification. So Paul tells us that these things were done for Abraham, but not for Abraham alone. It was not written just for his sake, but Paul says for ours as well. In other words, there is something very important to learn about Christian faith. There's something very important about the New Testament to learn from Abraham. And that is because our salvation comes in exactly the same way that his does. There wasn't a different plan of salvation in the Old Testament. Abraham was saved by faith, as we must be saved by faith. Moreover, Abraham was saved by faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, as we must be saved by faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. You say, now how was Abraham aware of Jesus Christ? Well, that he was aware of Jesus Christ can be seen. Let's look back first to John's Gospel, chapter 8. Jesus is engaged in controversy with the religious leaders, whom John typically calls the Jews. John 8, 48, the Jews answered him, "Are we not right in saying that you are a Samaritan and have a demon?" Jesus answered, "I do not have a demon, but I honor my Father, and you dishonor me. And I do not seek my own glory. There is one who seeks it, and he is the judge. Truly, truly, I say to you, if anyone keeps my word, he will never see death." The Jews said to him, "Now we know that you have a demon. Abraham died, as did the prophets. Yet you say, if anyone keeps my word, he will never taste death. Are you greater than our father Abraham, who died, and the prophets died? Who do you make yourself out to be?" Jesus answered, "If I glorify myself, my glory is nothing. It is my Father who glorifies me, of whom you say he is our God. But you have not known him. I know him. If I were to say that I do not know him, I would be a liar like you. But I do know him, and I keep his word. Your father Abraham rejoiced that he would see my day. He saw it and was glad." So the Jews said to him, "You are not yet 50 years old, and have you seen Abraham?" Jesus said to them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, before Abraham was, I am." So they picked up stones to throw at him, but Jesus hid himself and went out of the temple. Abraham rejoiced to see my day. In other words, Abraham was filled with delight and joy as he looked forward to the day of Jesus Christ, as he looked forward to the time when Jesus Christ would come into the world as the Savior of his people. He looked forward to that day. Well, how does John know that as he writes it? How did Jesus know that? Can we see that in the biblical text itself of Genesis? Well, the answer is yes, we can. Now, I'm going to walk you very quickly through the covenant made with Abraham on this. I want to focus on Genesis chapter 22. As I've mentioned here before, in Genesis chapter 15, God makes a covenant with Abraham for the first time. Abraham had received a promise going back into chapter 12 in Genesis, going back all the way before Abraham had left his home country, had come out of Ur of the Chaldees, and had come into the land that God had promised to give to him and to his descendants for everything. So God had spoken to Abraham, and God had given to Abraham a promise that if he would go out from his father's house, go to the land that God said that he would give to him and God would show to him, that God would make his name great there, that God would indeed give him that land, and that Abraham would have many descendants. That was the promise that God gave to Abraham. But as Abraham came into that land, he lived, and my estimate is, I think I've gone over this before, he lived there 10 years before God makes a covenant with him. I say 10 years because that's Genesis 15, the first time you see the word covenant appearing in the narrative of God's dealings with Abraham. It's not the first time in Genesis, but it's the first time since Genesis 12 when the story of Abraham picks up. So we have covenant in Genesis chapter 15. In Genesis 16, we know that Abraham is 86 years old, because it tells us. All right, so I'm guessing, back it up a little bit, he's been in the land approximately 10 years. And in Genesis 15, just after the war that he has had to rescue Lot and all the people of Sodom that had been taken captive, Abraham is coming back to his own camp. He is met by Melchizedek coming out of the city. He's met by the king of Sodom, etc. And we have that memorable meeting with Melchizedek. After all of that, God appears to Abraham, Genesis chapter 15, and tells him, once again, what he has promised to him. I am the Lord that brought you out of Ur of the Chaldees. And he makes the promise to Abraham concerning his many descendants, which Abraham answers with a question. Lord, what will you give me? I remain childless. You see, he's gone out in expectation of receiving a child. He's lived 10 years. Right, if somebody made you a promise 10 years down the road, they haven't kept that promise, might your faith begin to weaken a little bit? His was weakening a little bit. Lord, what will you give me? I remain childless. God said, you'll not remain childless. Someone is going to come forth from your own flesh. That will be your reward, Abraham. And then God reiterates the promise of the land. Now this is right in the passage where Abraham's justification is asserted. All right, God promises the seed. It's not going to be Eliezer of Damascus, one who comes forth from his own flesh and way. And we're told Abraham believed Yahweh, and it was reckoned to him as righteousness. So there it is, the central passage of justification by faith, quoted in Romans, quoted in Galatians, quoted even in James. That passage is at the center of the covenant that God makes. Abraham believed Yahweh, and it was reckoned to him as righteousness. Then God goes on and says he's going to give him the land as well. And once again, Abraham wants to know, how can I be sure? You see, this is the importance of the assurance thing. How can I know? How can I be sure that I will possess it? It's a case of Mark 9, in my opinion. It's, I believe, Lord, help my unbelief. Because he clearly believes, as verse 6 said to you, Abraham believed Yahweh. All right, that can't have been any false declaration of faith because the New Testament uses it as the passage concerning his justification. It was real faith, but it was not especially strong faith. But your faith doesn't need to be strong. The one in whom you have faith is strong enough for the both of you. So Abraham believed the Lord, but his faith needed help. How can I know? How can I be sure? After all, that land had just been threatened by recent war, which thankfully he won, but how long is it going to be before these kings rally and come back after him? So God gives him a covenant so that he can be sure. That's Genesis chapter 15. Won't go over that again. That's where the animals are cut in half. God passes between the pieces of the animal. God is invoking symbolically a curse upon himself, thus backing his promise with his life, saying, if I don't fulfill my promise, then the same thing will be done to me as has been done to these animals. God will have to die. That's Genesis 15. Now we get to Genesis 17. All right, we're going to skip over the Ishmael incident in chapter 16. Come to Genesis 17, and God once again comes back. This time, we're further down the road in time. He had lived 10 years, Abraham had lived 10 years before God makes a covenant with him. And God had given him that covenant in order for Abraham to be sure. But he was going to wait another 15 years before the covenant was actually fulfilled. And we pick him up just short of that time before Isaac is born when we get to Genesis chapter 17. And then comes that little wrinkle, that fly in the ointment. Because Genesis 15 seemed to be, by God alone passing between the pieces, the making of a covenant in which God alone was obligated. Because he's the only one passing between the pieces of the animal. It looks like a covenant that is absolutely unconditional. Because God makes a promise, he backs it up with his life, he makes a covenant with Abraham. But in Genesis 17, things change. Genesis 17, God says, walk before me and be blameless in order that I may establish my covenant with you. In order that I may establish my covenant with you. The fulfillment of the covenant hinges on the faithfulness of Abraham and his seed. The covenant will not be fulfilled if the seed of Abraham proves disobedient to the covenant. Genesis 17. As proof, I won't argue this at length. Was the covenant conditional or unconditional? Did Israel lose the land? Yeah, they got kicked out, didn't they? The Assyrians came and took away the northern tribe. Babylonians came, took away the southern kingdom. Why did they lose it? They were disobedient. Must have been a conditional covenant. Because they didn't keep the covenant, they lost the land. So, Genesis 17, walk before me, Bilamus, that I may establish my covenant with you. The sign of the covenant instituted at that point was circumcision. Circumcision, as we've talked about here before, won't argue it in detail again. Circumcision is a bloody rite. A little bit of blood is shed by way of forecast concerning the shedding of all the blood should there be disobedience. And the blood is shed precisely at the point where the promise is to be fulfilled, where Abraham is to have a seed. There must be, although the seed is going to contain Gentiles as well as Jews, there's got to be at least one Jew, because God has said he is going to bring forth a son from Abraham's flesh. Isaac will be the one in whom God's promise has its initial fulfillment with Abraham. So there's got to be a son. And so the bloody rite is performed precisely at the point where the promise is to be fulfilled or the curse is to be imposed. All right, who knows my favorite movie in life? Princess Bride. Okay. All right, one of the great literary classics of the 20th century. All right, turned into a movie. You will remember when our hero is in pursuit of the princess who has been captured. All right, the giant Fezzik has been left behind to do him in, and the way in which he is to do him in is to pick up a boulder about the size of a basketball and hit him in the head as he comes around the corner. And so, just in the movie, our hero comes around the corner, Inigo Montoya. And Fezzik throws the stone, and it misses him and smashes up against the rock. And our hero stops dead, and Fezzik says, "I don't have to miss." And our hero says, "I believe you." Now, we've been set up for this because Fezzik didn't think this was a very sporting thing to do. I mean, just hitting a guy in the head with a boulder, doing him in. You need to fight as God intended, and the better man will win. But Fezzik says, "I don't have to miss." That's what God is saying in circumcision. I don't have to miss. I can cut off your seed permanently. And I will do so if they prove to be unfaithful to this covenant. Walk before me and be blameless in order that I may keep my covenant with you, in order that I may establish. And he comes back to that in Genesis chapter 18. When God appears in the camp of Abraham to tell him this time next year, Sarah's going to have a son, there are two angels with him who are going to go down into Sodom. And as the angels head out from Abraham's camp to go down into Sodom to see whether the outcry that has come up to heaven against Sodom is indeed true, which is, of course, a very anthropomorphic passage. God doesn't have to send angels down there to find out whether it's true. But in order that we might know that God knows and they will prove themselves to be exactly what has been said about them, the angels go down. And as they're going off, God is standing there with Abraham. And then you get this little moment where Moses is able to give us the inner thoughts of God at this point in time. Shall I hide from Abraham what I'm about to do? It's not as if God doesn't know what he's going to do, but you get that little, shall I hide from Abraham? And then you get this line, seeing, in other words, knowing that, or because of, seeing that he will instruct his household after him to keep the way of the Lord, in order that the Lord might bring upon Abraham all that he has said, all that he has promised. Abraham is brought into the knowledge of God's judgment upon Sodom, because Abraham is to teach his household after him to keep the way of the Lord by doing righteousness and justice, in order that the Lord might bring upon Abraham that which he has promised. So faithfulness on the part of the seed of Abraham is necessary for the fulfillment of the covenant. There will not be blessing for Abraham or his seed apart from faithfulness in that seed. Abraham had figured it out. We know that in Genesis chapter 22. Now the promised seed is there, Isaac. And Isaac's now growing up. He's still a lad, but he's growing up. And the day comes when God says, now take your son, your only son, Isaac, whom you love, and offer him to me as a burnt offering on the mountain that I will show you. Now, I think you know enough about burnt offering to know that if you are offered as a burnt offering, you die. So, Isaac's going to be killed according to the commandment of God. Abraham doesn't hesitate. There's no bargaining like you get over the destruction of Sodom. Oh, what if this and what if that and so on. None of that. Next morning, Abraham is up early. He saddles his asses, takes his servants, and off he goes to the mountain where God will show him. When they get to the bottom of that mountain, Abraham says to the servants, because now the donkeys can't climb the mountain, you stay here with the donkeys. I and the lad will go yonder. We will worship, and we will return to you. You know, if you read this in Hebrew, as one of our outstanding Hebrew students of the past years that we've been in Columbia, Christina Massey could tell you she took Hebrew with Max Roglin. She was one of the best students we had. But as she could tell you, Hebrew is an inflected language. And so every time a verb appears, it appears with an ending that will tell you what its subject is, whether it's male or female, whether it's singular or plural. And all those verbs are plural. We will worship. We will return to you. All right? Now, this was not a White House press briefing where you can get up there and say whatever you want. All right? For either party, you just get up there and you lie through your teeth, all right? It has nothing to do with who's in power right now. You get up there and you try to spin the world the way you think you want people to believe. This is not that. This is truth being spoken. We will worship. We will return to you. Now, is it because Abraham has determined in his heart he's not going to do it? That he's already resolved he's not going to do it? Well, that's certainly not what goes on, because you follow the narrative on. He had that knife raised. He was just ready to bring down that giant knife upon Isaac, and that would have been the end of it. He was going to do exactly what he had been commanded to do. But the author of Hebrews, chapter 11, tells you what had gone on here. Abraham, after he had received this commandment, was pondering the promise of God. He had received a commandment that Isaac should be killed. But as he went over this in his mind concerning all that he had known of God, all that he had spoken with God, he remembered that God had said, through Isaac, your descendants shall be named. You see, this wasn't a vague promise concerning some undefined seed. This seed was coming through Isaac. Through Isaac, your descendants shall be named. And so as he pondered the commandment of God, fully intent on carrying it out, He pondered the promise of God. And he knew that the promise of God could not fail because God had backed it with his life. God can't die. So that promise is going to be kept, even if Isaac is killed. How could that possibly be? Hebrews 11 says he considered that God was able to raise even the dead. Abraham had figured out that the covenant would hinge on the resurrection of the dead. How about that? That's pretty smart, right? For a guy that can't count the number of stars in the sky, even that unknown galaxy that the Webb telescope just discovered out there, for a guy that can't count the number of stars in the sky, that he had figured out. The covenant will be fulfilled by the resurrection of the dead. So he believed he was coming down off that mountain with Isaac, because through Isaac his descendants would be named. But as he came down from that mountain, of course, Isaac was not dead or raised to life. He had been spared. If you remember, as they ascended the mountain, Isaac was beginning to wonder what was going on here too. And he said, "Father, here's the fire. Here's the wood." And it's not said, but I'm sure he noticed. I see that knife by your side too. Here's the fire, here's the wood. Where's the ram for the sacrifice? And Abraham says, God will provide himself the ram for the sacrifice. Which could mean that God himself will provide the ram for the sacrifice. Or that God will provide himself as the ram for the sacrifice. You're left wondering. I don't think Abraham was. Not after Isaac was spared. Not after Isaac was spared. So he commemorated that event by naming that mountain again. This is Mount Moriah. Mount Moriah is where David had bought the threshing floor of Ornan the Jebusite. That's where the temple was built, according to the commandment of David, which had been received from God. That was the place where heaven and earth, that was in that day, the nearest place where heaven touched earth. Okay, Columbia, South Carolina was that place last Sunday night. But on that, it was there, and that's where the temple was built. And Abraham named that mountain Yahweh Yireh, probably better known because of songs and whatnot, Jehovah Jireh. All right, but Jehovah's a corruption of the divine name. It's an attempt to pronounce the consonants of God's name with the vowels of the word Adonai. So Yahweh Yireh, or Jehovah Jireh, doing it better, which is the Lord will provide. Yahweh shall provide. It's not a commemoration of what has happened. It is a prophecy of what will happen. It's looking to the future, not to the past. The past, the most recent past, has opened the door for Abraham. Because if it's not Isaac, then it must be somebody else. And that mountain has opened up the future. So that he knows that on this mountain, Yahweh will provide himself as the ram for the sacrifice. That's why Jesus says in John chapter 8, Abraham rejoiced to see my day. He saw it and was glad. Well, with that background, you will read the opening of Luke's gospel. With, I think, an extra step in your guilt. You have Luke's opening preface, verses 1-4. he tells you that he's going to give you a narrative. A narrative that arises out of the fact that he has followed all things carefully from the beginning. He's going to give you a narrative what? Concerning the things, and the ESV just simply says, so weakly in my opinion, the things that have been accomplished. All right? This is not a narrative of just things that were done. The Greek word is pleroforeo, that's the basic verb involved, which means brought to its fulfillment. These were not just things that were brought to pass. They weren't just things that happened in the course of history. These were things fulfilling a plan. They have been brought to their fulfillment. That's the narrative. So where does the narrative begin for Luke? He's going to show us how in the life of Jesus Christ, those things that were promised have been brought to fulfillment. Where does it begin? And in the days of Herod the king of Judea, there was a priest named Zechariah of the division of Abijah, and he had a wife from the daughters of Aaron, and her name was Elizabeth. And they were both righteous before God, walking blamelessly in all the commandments and statutes of the Lord. In other words, they had been faithful, but they had no child. But they had no child. You see, if you're a reader of the Old Testament, all of a sudden, the hair stands up on the back of your neck. Because you've read enough in the Old Testament to know, every time a barren woman shows up, get out the way, God is coming through. Something big is going to happen. But they had no child. You say, look out! You know, this is just like watching Jaws and you hear that timpani start to play. You know the shark is coming. As soon as you hear the drum, that's the barren woman in the Old Testament. In a time of need, they had no child. You just get out the way. Here comes God. And it's an old couple without a child. Well, where have you read that story before? You see that it's going to come to pass just as it had been foretold. That just as there had been an old couple who was barren, and who would not be able to enjoy the promises of God without the fulfillment of the promise to give them a child, so it is here. There will not be fulfillment for all of Israel if they remain childless. And they will bring forth, of course, John the Baptist, who will be the greatest of the prophets of old because he will point out the Lord Jesus Christ when he comes. Now, Zechariah, of course, had undoubtedly prayed a long time for a child, but my guess is by this stage in life, they've probably stopped praying that prayer. They might have even forgotten about that prayer. Probably hadn't forgotten the fact that they didn't have a child. But as we notice here, they had soldiered on. They had lived their whole life with God not answering their prayer. For probably the one thing in life they would have exchanged for everything else. It would have been the greatest blessing in their life. But it had been withheld. And God hadn't pulled them aside and said, look, you're going to have a son. I'm going to give you a son. And when I do, it's going to be the greatest man that has ever lived up to that point in time. He will be a prophet that goes before the Lord. He will announce salvation that has come. That's who your child will be. He will get to introduce the main event. But he didn't pull them aside and tell them that. They had to live, just trusting and believing in God, despite the fact that he had said no to the thing that they had wanted most in life. And when the angel came and said to Zechariah, your prayer has been heard, he didn't believe it. That angel had put his finger on a very sore point in Zechariah's life, and he didn't like having the sore point pressed on. And he says, how shall I know this? Just like Abraham before him, how shall I know this? According to what? The fact that you're an angel standing here in the temple of God, is that supposed to be enough? Give me more. And he was sentenced, being deaf and mute for the period of that pregnancy. But when that child was born, it was clear that God was doing what he had promised. Zechariah sings, "Blessed be the Lord God of Israel." This is Luke 1, beginning at verse 67. 68 begins the song. "Blessed be the Lord God of Israel, for he has visited and redeemed his people, and he has raised up a horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David, as he spoke by the mouth of his holy prophets from of old, that we should be saved from our enemies and from the hand of all who hate us, to show the mercy promised to our fathers and to remember his holy covenant, the oath that he swore to our father, Abraham, to grant us that we, being delivered from the hand of our enemies, might serve him without fear in holiness and righteousness before him all our days." All in one sentence. Then he goes on to talk about his son John. But what's he celebrating? God has kept his covenant. God has kept his promise. Here's a guy that, like Abraham, had lived nearly his whole life without God doing the thing that he wanted the most. And now he celebrates that God had done it. You know, it's one of the great things about Christmas. In our day, Christmas has become a children's festival. All right? We want kids to have everything they want. All right? I remember one grandfather here was telling me about the excitement of his children coming home, but the great excitement was they were bringing the grandchildren with them. And when he met them at the airport and they got off the plane and here come those grandkids, he said, "Welcome to the land of whatever you want." It was his goal to be the most indulgent grandfather that you can imagine. Welcome to the land of whatever you want. Well, that's what Christmas is. But it's not for children. It's for old folks who have lived their whole lives without receiving the thing they wanted the most. It means that nobody has to die believing that they won't get what they really wanted. If what you want in your heart, salvation through the Lord Jesus Christ, if you want to live in the blessing of God, if you want to live in that land where he wipes away every tear from your eyes, where there's no longer any death, neither mourning nor crying nor pain anymore, if you want to live in that land, Christmas is for you. The thing I love about Luke is that for him, Christmas bunch of old folks. Simeon, Anna, Zechariah, Elizabeth. I don't know how old the shepherds were, but there's a bunch of old people there. They've been waiting all their life. And Luke wants you to know they will not die in disappointment. You can be assured. These things have been brought to fulfillment. Merry Christmas. Let's pray together. Lord, how we thank you that you are a covenant-keeping God, that what was promised to Abraham so long ago, you have indeed brought to fulfillment. His promised seed has indeed been born. The sign of the covenant was placed upon him, because he would indeed be the one who would bear the curse to set everyone else free. So we thank you that in this Christmas season, whatever disappointments we have, whatever brokenness we have experienced, whatever pains we must endure, whatever losses we have suffered, we can live in hope and in the fullness of expectation that the deepest longings of our heart will indeed be satisfied in the Lord Jesus Christ, who has brought to pass all that the prophets foretold. We give our thanks in Jesus' name. Amen.